focus this morning, as we're making our way through the Olivet Discourse in Mark, is in Mark 13. And so you can turn there first of all, where we'll spend most of our time. But I do want to encourage you now, just because this passage is filled with Old Testament references, that you can at least begin now your Bible search through the Old Testament and mark, if you will, the book of Daniel and the book of Isaiah. Those are some key passages that we'll be turning to. If you're not sure where those are, turn to someone beside you. I'm sure they'd be able to help you, more than willing to help you. But Isaiah and Daniel will be some of the other passages that we'll look at briefly. But Mark 13,
verses 24 through 27 is our text this morning, and that's what we want to read before we pray. I remind you that this takes place within the broader context of what's called the Olivet Discourse, as Jesus sat on the Mount of Olives and taught his disciples the answer to the question that they had asked him. He had said that the days were coming in which the temple that stood there in Jerusalem, not one stone would remain upon another. And they ask him, when will these things be and what will be their sign? And that is the catalyst for the Olivet Discourse in which Jesus is explaining these things to them. And so we will jump in at 24 and read through 27. That'll be our focus this morning. This is the Word of God, Mark 13, beginning in verse 24. This is following right upon the heels of the great tribulation that he has described. Verse 24 says this, this is the Word of God, "But in those days, after that tribulation, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light. The stars of heaven will fall, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. And then he will send his angels and gather together his elect from the four winds, from the farthest part of earth to the farthest part of heaven." Amen. May God bless the reading of his word. Let us pray and seek God's help one final time as we come to the preaching of his word. If you would bow with me, let's pray together. Our gracious God and Father, we again come to you pleading for your help in understanding your word. Lord, we pray for your Holy Spirit to give us eyes to see and ears to hear. Lord, even as we considered in our Sunday school class this morning, we are sinful by nature. We are those who suppress and reject the truth. And it is only by the renewal, the moral renewal of your Spirit by which we actually come intellectually to comprehend and to submit to your word accurately. Lord, we pray that you would teach us things from your word. We pray with the psalmist that you would cause us to behold wondrous things from your law. Father, we pray that your word would saturate your people, that the word of Christ would dwell in us richly. Lord, we pray that we would understand this passage of your word as the apostles and as Jesus himself would have understood it. Lord, help us to challenge even our own presuppositions, which at this point are certainly a hurdle for us to overcome. We pray, Lord, that you'd be gracious to us. Help us to love one another as we've made our way and we continue to make our way through this difficult and challenging discourse. Lord, that we would have humility and that we would seek above all to know and to submit to what your word teaches. Lord, help us again, we pray, for those who are here who don't know Christ. Lord, may this text be the one that your Spirit uses to bring them to spiritual life. May they come and bow the knee to the Lord Jesus, the King of Kings, for salvation from sin and peace with God. Lord, draw near to us, we pray. We ask for your help, and we ask all these things in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen. Well, as we've made our way through the Olivet Discourse, this is now the third sermon in Mark 13. My main approach, you'll remember, has been to argue that verse 30 of Mark 13 is the key transition text. It is the time marker that Jesus gives of when all these things should come to pass. And he says that time marker is in this generation. And I take the position that he meant that in the straightforward sense, that before that present generation that was alive when Jesus was speaking, before they would die, they would witness all these things he speaks about in the first 29 verses actually come to pass. And then, as we'll consider next time, and as I mentioned in the first sermon, I do believe at verse 32 then, there is a transition in which he begins to speak no longer of those days, but of that day singular, which I do think is a reference to a second coming at the end of the world. Now, admittedly, if there is one particular section of the Olivet Discourse that at face value seems to pose a problem to that interpretation, it is verses 24 through 27. Now, I'm going to argue this morning that a big part of that has nothing to do with the fact that Jesus spoke unclearly or that he's using some sort of double fulfillment, but rather the main hurdle and problem for us is our own assumptions and our own 21st lenses that we bring to the Bible. Those, I'm going to argue, are indeed our biggest obstacle. We have a lot going against us to make us prejudiced against the interpretation I'm going to suggest to you this morning. We have simply always assumed, as I've said, when we read our Bibles and our devotions, that this is a second coming text. That's what this is. We've been taught by others that that's what is being referred to here. For many of us, we've read Tim LaHaye. We've seen the Left Behind series, right? And we know, well, it's got to be gospel truth. I mean, this looks like what's portrayed in those movies, and so that's got to be what this passage is talking about. I mean, after all, if you're looking at the text, it does use the language, they will see the Son of Man coming. And not only that, but he's coming in the clouds with great power and glory. Heavenly anomalies are taking place here. Does that not seem to be a reference to Jesus' great and final coming at the end of the world? And yet, I remind you, Jesus said after these verses that all these things will come to pass before that generation comes to an end. So what do we say to that? Well, let me lay out the options for you this morning before we just dive back in. If I'm wrong, first of all, let me start here. If I'm wrong, and I've told you as we've been working through this, I'm very open and I've appreciated the discussion and the feedback and the challenges that I've had with many of you in terms of, okay, but how do we fit this in and how does this work and what about Matthew and Luke and things like that. I've appreciated that and I've told you from the beginning, I will be your friend even if we land in different places on this. So don't worry, we're not going to break fellowship. But I need to say, if I am wrong and if this is indeed a reference to Jesus' final coming at the end of the world, then I owe you some correcting sermons. Okay, I must alter what I've said to you up until this point. And I want you to see this, and I want you to see why. First of all, look at verse 24 of Mark 13. Mark says, "But in those days, after that tribulation." Now, you don't have to turn there, but I'll just tell you, if you read Matthew's parallel of that verse, Matthew includes the word "immediately after that tribulation." In other words, what's assumed in Mark here is made explicit in Matthew, that whatever event verses 24 through 27 are speaking about, Jesus says it happens immediately after the days of the great tribulation that he has just described. Okay? That's another time marker. These two are put together by Jesus. Now, unless you want to interpret Matthew's word "immediately" to mean something like more than, 2,000 years now, which I don't think any of us want to do, we have to wrestle with this. Since these two events are connected by Jesus, we have to do one of two things. Either those days of tribulation, which Jesus has just been describing, cannot refer to the events of 70 AD and the destruction of the temple, which you remember, I argued they do refer to the destruction of the temple in the first century. And rather, they must refer to a tribulation that is still yet off in the future, right? Because the second coming hasn't happened. Since the second coming happens right after the tribulation has to be off in the future. That's one option. Or there's a second option, which is an unorthodox one, which none of us dare take this morning. And that's, well, if the tribulation did refer to those events that happened in 70 AD, then Jesus apparently thought that his return was going to happen a long, long time ago. Now, we certainly don't want to take that second option because that would be tantamount to saying Jesus was wrong. And that's why many say yes. And so there's only one other option. We need to accept the first, We need to accept that the great tribulation Jesus was describing was not something that had sole or particular reference to the first century, the things that these disciples would actually experience, but it's something that lasts throughout the whole church age, and then, at the end of that, Jesus' second coming will happen. Now, the problem with that, and I've said this to you before in previous sermons, is I think that, at least as far as I have interpreted and tried to understand this passage, I think that makes absolute nonsense of Jesus' statements. Jesus does not seem to be describing a general tribulation that will extend throughout the whole church age. After all, remember, Jesus said explicitly in Luke 21, when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies. It's very particular, right? Is that going to happen in the future? I don't think so. Jesus has also given them specific directions tied to that particular generation and that particular geographical area, right? He said, if you're in Judea, flee and go into the mountains. It seems to me Jesus was very clearly telling these disciples about a particular event they would experience and giving them instructions on what to do when it came upon them. And so if that's true, then what do we do? It seems we're in between a rock and a hard place. Unless verses 24 through 27 is not a reference to Jesus' final coming at the end of the age. And again, I suggest to you that we take Jesus' words in verse 30 seriously. This generation will not pass away until all these things take place, including verses 24 through 27. Now, getting into our passage, just reminding you of context here. I remind you that Jesus is teaching his disciples, as I already mentioned, about how they will know that the prophecy that the temple is going to be destroyed will be fulfilled. They ask that question in verse 4. And he uses, you remember, the analogy of a pregnancy, right? He says, at first, there are going to be things that take place, that must take place, but the end is not yet. I hope you remember that. And he said, these are the beginnings of birth pangs, right? We said those were the Braxton Hicks, right? They were kind of the precursor to the active labor and things like that. He said, wars, rumors of wars, earthquakes, famines, persecution, etc. Jesus says, when you see these things, don't be alarmed, right? The end is not yet upon you. But then, verse 14, he brings us closer to the birth, we said. There's more urgency now. It's active labor. He says, when you see the abomination of desolation standing where he ought not, and you remember Luke interprets that as when you see the armies of Rome surrounding Jerusalem, Jesus says, then the time is upon you. It's at the door. Flee Jerusalem. Don't go back into the city if you're in the fields. Don't go down into your house if you're on the rooftops. It is time to get out because birth is upon you. But what he hasn't yet described is the event itself, the actual birth, we might say. He has told them what will lead up to the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple, but he has not yet actually recorded D-Day, the destruction of the city of Jerusalem and the temple. And that, I suggest to you, brothers and sisters, is precisely what we have in verses 24 through 27. This is a record of the Lord Jesus' judgment upon Jerusalem. Okay, now, let me qualify. I've said this, but I need to say it in every sermon in case people listen who don't know me, and this is the only sermon they ever hear. Make no mistake, I tenaciously hold to a still yet future coming of the Lord Jesus Christ in which he will return bodily. He will raise the dead. He will judge the righteous and the wicked. He will establish the eternal state. But that is not what this passage is talking about. This is Jesus' climactic description of what he has already said in verse 2, that not one stone will be left upon another. But here, and here's the difference, here he does not describe it in prosaic, ordinary language like in verse 2, but rather here he speaks of it in the richly colored and evocative language of the Old Testament prophecies. We probably don't realize this as English readers in the 21st century. We are not nearly as familiar and saturated with our Old Testament as Jesus was and his apostles were. almost every single word found in these verses is drawn from the prophets of the Old Testament. Nearly every word. It's possible that there are many of us in this room who read this and we don't recognize that any of them are quotations from the Old Testament. And as I said, that is, I think, the main reason we are liable to misunderstand this section, because we read these words through our 21st century lenses rather than through the lenses of Jesus and the apostles, who were absolutely steeped in Old Testament thought and language. And so I want to encourage us this morning to try to the best of our ability to temporarily suspend any prejudice and assumptions you might have and try to transport yourself back to the original hearers and ask, what would they have understood this section to mean? Jesus was speaking to a people saturated in Old Testament language, concepts, and imagery. Remember, just as we catechize our kids every Lord's Day, they would have been taught and catechized and even memorized the Old Testament from the very young years. And thus, when Jesus speaks to them of things here with prophetic vocabulary, they would have instantly recognized what it was he was referring to. Okay, three main points here this morning, and then we'll draw application. Three main points. If you find it helpful to take notes, you can turn your bulletin over on the back. We've given you some blank lines and the main headings of this sermon if it helps you to kind of hang your thoughts on those main things. But the first thing we want to see this morning is the cataclysmic judgment of Jerusalem. The cataclysmic judgment of Jerusalem. If you look again at verses 24 and 25, Jesus says, "But in those days, after that tribulation, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, the stars of heaven will fall, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken." Now, there's a lot of talk in our day that says, and they'll say this to people like me, if you don't interpret your Bible, what? Literally, then you don't take your Bible seriously, right? If you don't interpret your Bible literally, you're not believing the Bible. Jesus said here, the sun would go dark, the moon would not give its light, stars will fall from heaven. And we know that that didn't happen in 70 AD, so why would you say that this is a reference to 70 AD? Let me respond to that. No one interprets the Bible in an absolutely wooden, strictly literal way. And to prove that, let me ask you this question. Do you believe this morning that God actually has a right hand? Do you believe that God actually has wings? Right? Is God a bird? I think all of us in this room would say, no, God is spirit. He doesn't have any physical material. He's not made of matter. He is a spirit. And yet the psalm says that he does. Psalm says he has a right hand. Psalm says that he has wings and pinions that cover his people. No one interprets the Bible that way, because that's not how language works. Language is full of imagery and pictures. Of course I want to interpret my Bible literally, if by that we mean what the Bible actually means by what it says as it interprets itself. Let me give you an example of that. Say, for instance, 300 years from today, 300 years into the future, a man is walking along, goes into a used bookstore, and he picks up a book that was written in our year, 2019. And he opens this book, and it's 300 years removed from its original context, and he lands upon this sentence. On summer break, the students were in the habit of painting the town red. And he closes that book and he concludes to himself, man, college students had weird ways of filling their summer break. Where do you get that much paint? Why would you want to paint a town red? Would any of us say that that reader is doing justice to the literal intention of that author? Of course not. We all understand the author was saying they partied on summer break. It has nothing to do with red paint, but that's exactly what we're doing if we make this language mean literally, according to our 21st century lenses, if we mean these to be literal, cosmic, miraculous disturbances that are actually happening in the sky. And now that's an assertion I'm making, but I want you to see it for yourselves. All we have to do is pull out our concordance, right? A little bit of Bible study goes a long way. Pull out your concordance, pull out your treasury of scripture knowledge, and we will find multiple places in the Old Testament where this exact language of heavenly disturbance is used in the Old Testament, not to refer literally to things going on in heaven, but to refer to the judgment of God that is going on upon the earth, particularly the judgment of God on particular nations. So I said at the beginning, mark Isaiah. I don't know if any of you were able to do that, but if not, turn over to Isaiah 13. I just want you to see one of these. I'll read a couple more. If you're fast, you can keep up with me. But I at least want you to land your eyes physically on one of these so that you can see I'm not just, doing smoke and mirrors here with you. Isaiah 13, if you would look at verse 10. I'll wait till I hear pages stop flipping so I know that you're there and you can see it. Isaiah 13, verse 10. Listen to what Isaiah says. The stars of heaven and their constellations will not flash forth their light. The sun will be dark when it rises, and the moon will not shed its light. Now you read that, and you say to yourself, man, Isaiah must be seeing the second coming, right? He must be talking about whatever Jesus is talking about, his return at the end of the age. But then you glance up at verse 1 of that chapter. If you're still there, look at verse 1 of chapter 13. What does it say? The burden against Babylon, which Isaiah the son of Amoz saw. Isaiah was describing the destruction of Babylon. He wasn't describing the second coming. There was not heavenly disturbances that really came to pass. It was a cataclysmic judgment upon Babylon. Okay, let me give you a couple more. You can turn there if you're fast, but otherwise just listen. Ezekiel 32, 7 and 8. God says, when I put out your light, I will cover the heavens and make its stars dark. I will cover the sun with a cloud, and the moon shall not give her light. And the bright lights of the heavens I will make dark over you and bring darkness upon your land, says the Lord God. Now again, who is he talking to? Well, Ezekiel 32, verse 2 says, Son of man, take up a lamentation for Pharaoh, king of Egypt. He's describing the destruction of Egypt and Pharaoh. Another one, Isaiah 34, 4 and 5. And all the host of heaven will wear away, and the sky will be rolled up like a scroll. All their hosts will also wither away as a leaf withers from the vine, or as one withers from the fig tree. For my sword is satiated in heaven. Behold, it shall descend for judgment upon, not the whole world, upon Edom and upon the people whom I have devoted to destruction. Brothers and sisters, all three of those judgments from the prophets of the Old Testament have come and have gone in history. They've already taken place. They've already been destroyed. And in none of them did these heavenly signs literally take place. Jesus is not predicting that strange astronomical events will occur at the end of the world. He's predicting, like an Old Testament prophet, the cataclysmic judgment of God, no longer on Edom or Babylon, but this time on Jerusalem, on the nation of the Jews, formally demolishing the centerpiece of the Old Covenant, the temple. This is language that is meant to communicate that an old kingdom, an old economy is being brought down, namely the old covenant with Israel, governed by the law, and God is bringing in a new order, a new economy, the new covenant in Christ. That's what the book of Hebrews, if you read the book of Hebrews, this is all over that epistle. When it says things, for instance, just one example, in chapter 8, verse 13, the writer to the Hebrews says, in speaking of a new covenant, he makes the first one obsolete. And then notice what he says. And what is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away. Now, we can talk about that later, but I think perhaps that's an allusion to what the author knew was coming in the formal destruction of the temple, which marked the vanishing of the old covenant. Just like God, Jesus is saying, just like God destroyed Babylon and Egypt and Edom, so he will destroy Jerusalem. So that's the first thing I want us to see is the cataclysmic judgment of Jerusalem. But that brings us to the second thing here, what I'm calling the enthronement of the Son of Man in heaven. Now, just by the name of that point, you can see what position I'm taking here. But the enthronement of the Son of Man in heaven. We have to ask this question. You might be sitting here and thinking, okay, well, that's interesting. Maybe you never knew that the Old Testament used that kind of language, and okay, I'm going to have to think about that. But, I mean, what do we do with this language of the coming of the Son of Man in the clouds? Now, first of all, just a note that I didn't know where to include. This is more for our Greek students here this morning, in case you're following along in the original languages. And I didn't know where to put it, so I just thought, I'll just squeeze it in right here. It's interesting, Jesus does not use the Greek word parousia in this passage. All of us have probably heard that term, parousia. That's the Greek word that's most often used in reference to Jesus' final coming at the end of the age. That's not the word that's used here. The Greek word that's used here is erkomai, which all of our Greek students know means what? Either to come or to go, right? That's what erkomai means. Okay, well, Greek students aside over. So you guys just can hold on to that and you'll see the significance. Now, Jesus here says, they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds in great power and great glory. Now, let's be honest. When we read that verse, what do we immediately picture in our minds? What do we immediately picture? We picture the bodily return of the Lord Jesus coming from the clouds in heaven and coming down to the earth. Right? That's just what we think of. We think he's coming from heaven to earth. Now, here's a challenge for you, and it's one that you can, it's not even homework for later. You can actually do this right now as you're looking at Mark. Here's a challenge. Tell me where you see here in Mark 13 where it says the Son of Man is coming from heaven to earth. Tell me where you see it says something about the direction that he is coming. It doesn't say anything about the direction. We've assumed it does. In fact, you can read Matthew and Luke as well, and none of them either say that he's coming from heaven to earth. We've just assumed that. What it says is they will see the Son of Man coming or going on the clouds with great power and glory. Now, again, we need to ask this question. Is there any Old Testament text that might explain what Jesus was referring to here? And the answer to that is yes, absolutely. Jesus is alluding, almost verbatim, to a passage they were extremely familiar with, Daniel chapter 7. Turn there, back in your Old Testament, Daniel chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. Daniel chapter 7, look at verse 13, and we'll read verse 13 and 14. And pay attention with me here, okay? I want you to see this for yourself. Daniel 7, 13. Daniel says, I was watching in the night visions. Okay, he's having a vision. And behold, one like the Son of Man. Okay, there's our title. That's what Jesus is picking up on in Mark 13. What is he doing? What's the Son of Man doing? Coming with the clouds of heaven. Now, here is the key, absolutely key question to answer. Please tell me, according to Daniel, which direction was the Son of Man coming in Daniel's vision? Is Daniel seeing him coming from heaven to earth in Daniel 7? The answer to that is no. He sees the Son of Man coming into heaven. Notice what the verse goes on to say. He came to the Ancient of Days. It doesn't say he came to earth. It says he came to the Ancient of Days. That's God the Father. And look, they brought him near before him. Daniel is witnessing here. We sung about it in our second hymn this morning. That's why I wanted to sing it. Daniel is witnessing a royal inauguration going on in heaven. Verse 14, they bring him before the Ancient of Days. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. Now mark that verse. That's going to be significant when we read the next verse in Mark about his messengers going into the four corners of the earth. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom the one which shall not be destroyed. Okay, now I want you to see, that's it for Daniel. I want you to see this. Unless Jesus is totally changing the original vision that Daniel saw in Daniel 7, unless he's totally changing the original vision of what Daniel saw, he's speaking not of them seeing the Son of Man coming to earth from heaven, but speaking of them seeing the Son of Man come into the presence of God in heaven to receive vindication and authority and a kingdom. Now, brother and sister, Christian, what does that sound like to you? What is the New Testament event that marks the beginning of Christ's heavenly reign? It is his ascension into heaven and his heavenly session at God's right hand. Brothers and sisters, I would submit to you, Daniel is not witnessing here the final second coming from heaven to earth. He's witnessing the ascension of the Lord Jesus after his victorious sacrifice and resurrection from the dead, and now returning to his Father to receive his kingdom, where he now sits down at the right hand of the majesty on high, as Paul says, where he will reign until he puts every enemy under his feet. Right? Think passages like Matthew 28, right? The Great Commission. What does Jesus say right before he ascends into heaven? All what? All authority. It's literally the same. If you compare the Septuagint of Daniel and the Greek of Matthew 28, it's the same word. All authority has been given to me, where? In heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, into all nations. Think passages like Ephesians 4. He ascended on high, leading captivity captive. Right? Jesus came to earth, and he made captive captivity itself, and he leads them back into heaven as the majestic conquering king. Now, let me give you even more support in case you're kind of, okay, maybe, I'm not sure. If you would turn to Matthew 26, verse 62. Matthew 26 probably will be a little bit easier for you to find. Very beginning of the New Testament. Sometimes those Old Testament prophets, we forget the order of them and where exactly they come. Matthew 26. Look at verse 62, and we'll read through verse 64. And the high priest arose and said to him, this is Jesus on trial, he's about to be arrested, or not arrested, he's about to be condemned and crucified. Verse 62 of Matthew 26, the high priest arose and said to him, do you answer nothing? What is it these men testify against you? But Jesus kept silent. And the high priest answered and said to him, I put you under oath by the living God. Tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God. And notice Jesus' answer, verse 64. Jesus said to him, it is as you said, nevertheless, I say to you, hereafter you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of power, and notice the phrase, and coming on the clouds of heaven. Now, you might not agree with me, but I am struggling to find another way to understand that, except to understand it, that Jesus interpreted his own coming on the clouds of heaven as synonymous with his taking his seat at the right hand of power. And we all agree the New Testament is replete with verses that say that happened not at his final second coming, but at his ascension into heaven. I'll give you just a few here. You don't have to turn. You can mark them down for later. Acts 7, 55 and 56. But Stephen, being full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing where? At the right hand of God. And he said, look, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. Romans 8, 34. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God. Hebrews 1, 3. Christ being the brightness of the Father's glory and the express image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Jesus is describing in Mark 13 his ascension. He is describing and the sign which will prove to the Jews that he is indeed the one who has come on clouds of glory to the Father to receive all authority. Listen, just as we bring this point to a close, listen to how one commentator, he can say it much better than I can, so I just figured I'm going to quote him and I'll throw him in here. Listen to how one commentator, France, describes the significance of this statement that Jesus says. He says, quote, Jesus is using Daniel 7:13 as a prediction of that authority which he exercised when in AD 70 the Jewish nation and its leaders who had condemned him were overthrown, and Jesus was vindicated as the recipient of all power from the Ancient of Days. He goes on, Jesus, exalted after his death and resurrection to receive his everlasting dominion, will display that dominion within the generation by an act of judgment on the nation and capital of the authorities who presume to judge him. Then they will see for themselves that their time of power is finished, and it is to him that God has given all power in heaven and on earth. Close quote. I think that's exactly right. Jesus is saying here to the disciples and to that generation, he is saying here not that they will physically in 70 AD see the Son of Man in heaven, and that's not what he's saying, but they're going to see the proof or the sign that he is in heaven, and they will perceive that he is indeed the exalted Lord of glory. And in case you think that I'm stretching that word in this text a little bit by saying the sign, I encourage you to read Matthew later, that that's exactly the language Matthew uses. Matthew says they will see the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And I think what he is saying is they will see the sign in the destruction of Jerusalem that the Son of Man is indeed in heaven and has received all authority. That's what he's saying here. When they see the destruction of the temple, they're going to know Jesus was who he says is who he said he was. They're going to know that he is the Son of Man who sits at the right hand of the Ancient of Days and is now wielding his dominion. And it will be crystal clear to them that God has at that moment taken the kingdom of God away from them and given all dominion to the one they crucified. That brings us to the third and final thing here before our application. The kingdom of God going to the whole world. I'll be more brief here. The kingdom of God going to the whole world. In conjunction with that vindication of the Son of Man in heaven, in which they will perceive that Jesus is the one of whom Daniel spoke, in conjunction with the destruction of Jerusalem, will mark the decisive declaration that the kingdom of God is going into all the nations. Okay, that's a very significant thing. We read this, and we, again, from our 21st century lenses, we don't think very much of the kingdom of God going broader than the Jews. That was very, very controversial for a Jewish person to hear here. But that is what he is declaring here. Now, we already saw that Jesus said this would begin to happen even in the period leading up to the destruction of Jerusalem. Remember, he said, the gospel will be preached to all nations. But the destruction of the temple is God's final demonstration that the old covenant economy is done and the new covenant economy is here. God is bringing in a new world order, one that is very different than the old one, one that is the fulfillment of all those pictures that the old covenant pointed to, specifically with regard to the physical temple of Jerusalem. Jesus is saying it is now going to be obsolete. Jesus is saying never again will people stream into Jerusalem in order to meet with God in the temple building. Think about that. Coming from the Jewish perspective, the disciples' perspective, the temple was the heart of Old Testament worship and life. To worship God, he did not come to you in the Old Covenant. You came to him at his appointed place, the temple. That's where the sacrifices were. That's where the priestly duties were carried out. But now in Christ, in the New Covenant, that old system is being torn down. And you remember, if you just think of the gospel accounts, you remember the tearing down of the temple started to happen the very day that Jesus died. You remember what happened the moment he commended his spirit to his Father and he breathed his last? What happened? The veil of the temple that separated the holy God from the people was torn in two. In what direction? From top to bottom, showing that it was God himself in Christ, who is removing, tearing apart this divider, this barrier between him and his people through the death of his son. And it began then, but it would be finally entirely torn down some 40 years later. And now in this new economy, God is, through his messengers, going out into all the world to bring his elect to himself through the preaching of the crucified and risen Messiah, the new king that everything pointed to, the new temple, the new mediator. If you look at this verse, Mark says, Jesus says, that he will send out his angels. And literally, it's just the Greek word, again, Greek students know this, it's just the Greek word angelos, which oftentimes is translated as angels. It could be that here. I do think that there's an angelic attendance to the preaching of the Word of God. But probably a better translation would simply be for it to say, he will send out his messengers. That's the most basic meaning of that word. And I think this is a reference to the human messengers of Christ going out into the nations with the proclamation of the gospel. Again, think of what Jesus said, Matthew 16, that I will build my church, and what? The gates of hell will not prevail against it. That's a picture of the church, the messengers of Christ, going into and infiltrating the kingdoms of hell to plunder them through the proclamation of the gospel. Sometimes we think of that in the exact opposite. We think, well, Jesus is saying that even though all hell breaks loose against us, he'll protect us. No, gates don't come against you. You go against gates. And that's what Jesus is saying. My church is going to come up against the gates of hell. It's going to break them down through the proclamation of the gospel. And I'm going to get my people. And again, brothers, sisters, even if you disagree with me on this passage, it's okay. But I'm convinced we miss a vital evangelistic point if we see this as the end of the world gathering of God's people. That day is coming. Don't get me wrong. Jesus will return in glory, and he will gather to himself not only the elect, he'll gather everyone who has ever lived, and he will separate the sheep from the goats. But this gathering of the elect happens long before that gathering. This is the demonstration of what Daniel said would be given to the Son of Man. I told you to mark that verse when I read it. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom. Why? That all the peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. This sending out of the gospel of the kingdom to the uttermost parts of the earth is the demonstration that Christ has been enthroned not only as king who will crush his enemies, that is true, but as the king who will save his people. Christ came on a mission. What was that mission? He tells us all over the place in the Gospels, in particular John 6. What was his mission? That all whom the Father has given to me will come to me, and I will raise them up on the last day. Christ came to purchase every single citizen of his kingdom whom the Father had given him from before the foundation of the world. And that people did not just include those from the Jews, like these 11 who are standing here listening to him and the many other physically Jewish people who would come into Christ. But that was a number that included elect from Africa, elect from China, elect from America, elect that will span the ages. And he's about to purchase them in 3 days' time. Again, remember where Jesus is in his ministry here as he speaks these words. In 3 days, he will be the one who gives himself in place of his people, dying in their stead, bearing God's wrath in their place. And when he raises from the dead and he ascends into heaven, he is going to see every single one for whom he died by the Spirit of God and through the proclamation of the gospel, come and bow the knee to him that loved me before I loved him. And you know what Isaiah says? The very end of Isaiah 53. It says the Messiah will see the labor of his soul. That is, he will see the fruit of pouring his life out unto death. And Isaiah says, and he will be satisfied. This is a glorious passage. It might not mean what we've always thought it to mean, but it carries in it, I'm convinced, amazing glories of the supremacy of Christ and his power as reigning king. How should we apply this? Let us close with three simple applications. I'll be brief so that we can be out of here with our fellowship meal. I have three simple applications. I think they're very vital for each and every one of us. Whether you're a believer here or whether you're still undecided and you're not sure what to do with Jesus of Nazareth, listen to these three applications that this passage teaches us. The first thing it teaches us is that we should tremble at the wrath of God. This passage teaches us we should tremble at the wrath of God. In a day, I said this I think a few weeks ago, in a day in which many pulpits in many churches preach a sissified Jesus, one who is merely meek and mild and all love, this passage declares that he is king, that he is the one who has all authority in his hand, and he is the one who will execute judgment upon his enemies. My friend, every single judgment of God we see in the scriptures, beginning with the flood, his judgments that we've even read about this morning upon Egypt and Babylon and Edom, and even the judgment upon Jerusalem, should be a prod that pushes us to seek refuge in the grace of God. They should tell us that God is a gracious God, but that he is also a holy and a just God, and there comes a point for every sinner in which the patience of God has run its course. My friend, we do not know when that day will be for us. My friend, do you still sit here unbelieving? While perhaps week after week you come and you sit under the Word of God, and again God extends his hands of mercy to you, do you still sit here undecided? This might be the last time that you are graced with the offers of God's willingness to save you. We don't know when our death will bring us and usher us suddenly into the presence of a holy God to give an account for our sins and our life. All the gracious warnings of his wrath and his judgment are just that. They are gracious because they drive us to Christ. And that brings us to the second application. We must see Jesus as the focal point of all true religion. That's the second application. We must see Jesus as the focal point of all true religion. This passage demonstrates vividly God's abomination of trying to come to him any other way but through Christ. What does this passage teach us? Earthly temples cannot save you. Animal sacrifices cannot save you. The religious offerings of your own good works, a so-called spirituality, a belief in a generic God, cannot do a single thing to save us. Only a living relationship with the Christ who reigns in heaven can do anything to save us and bring us to God. This passage teaches us of the exclusivity of Christ. There is no other way open that leads to peace with God and eternal life. If there is another way to get to God but through Christ, then Christ died in vain. We must cast all of our hope for redemption and forgiveness upon the only one who sacrificed himself upon Calvary's tree and rose 3 days later in their behalf. We must not fool ourselves in thinking we can come to God through a building. We come to God through a person. In faith, relinquishing all of our hope and confidence in other things to save us and trusting, grabbing hold of, resting upon the righteousness of Christ alone to save us. Brothers and sisters, friend, all other roads lead to hell. And we need to stand our ground on that in an age of pluralism, in an age that says all roads lead up the same mountain to the same God. It is not so. If that were so, God should have left the temple right where it stood and said, you can come to me through Jesus if you want. You can also come to me the old way, through the old covenant. You can come to me through Muhammad or through your own spirituality. No, Jesus says, he who does not know me does not know the Father. Only Christ, he's the only one. Only Christ can stand in that gap between us and God, which sin has created, and bring us safely to the other side. That brings us to the third application as we close. We should be eager messengers of this kingdom. We should be eager messengers of this kingdom. Let me ask you this morning, do you want a vision to live for? Do you want a purpose in life? Get into this vision of serving the Lord of glory, who now sits in heaven and employs us as messengers to speak his word and build his church and build his kingdom. Brothers and sisters, I want to encourage you this morning. Don't be ashamed of the simplicity and the power of the bare gospel to save. This passage this week has revived my soul for evangelism. Christ is, as he says here, sending out his messengers into all the world and bringing in all the elect for whom he died. And we get to be a part of that. We were saved that way. Every single one of us in this room who is a Christian, you were converted because someone cared enough about you to actually share the good news of Christ crucified and risen and reigning in heaven. And the Lord opened your eyes. And now we get to carry on that work. We get to be a part of carrying on the baton of the message of the gospel. Brother and sister, what about your family? What about those you work with, your neighbors, those on the street? You know, we often, and I include myself in this, we often think that we have to just masterfully craft and dress up the gospel to make it more appealing to natural man. We don't need to do that. If you dress up the gospel to make it appealing to the natural man, you have altered the gospel. All we need to do is open our mouths and declare, you're a sinner just like me in need of saving grace. Christ has died and risen and has ascended, and he's coming again to judge the living and the dead. And he promises you, if you respond by having trust in him, faith, and repenting of your sins, you will be saved from the wrath of God. And God will make it effectual in the ears of his elect. Bethany, what about world missions? This is a world missions text. Would that God would raise up from our own congregation those who are willing to leave it all behind and go into these nations to bring the light of the gospel to them. We pray for those groups every Thursday night, an unreached people group who does not have a Christian witness. We should pray for that. And if we're fearful, we should pray that God would take away our fear. You know, God does that. Those who were once just timid and fearful, through prayer and through reading the scriptures, through getting bigger glimpses of the glory of Christ, gathering his elect, all of a sudden become powerful tools that God uses to bring in multitudes to Christ. Brothers and sisters, we live in a day here and now, not even talking about foreign missions, in which the gospel that I'm preaching this morning is becoming more and more hate speech. And I mean it. I'm not one of those guys who says the sky is falling. I'm actually very cautious against those things. But I mean it when I say the days may not be as far off as we thought they were when your pastors are put in jail or fined for saying the things that we say from this pulpit. And that's okay. We don't have to fear that. Jesus says, rejoice when you're persecuted for righteousness' sake. That's not the end. If we go to jail, that's not the end of Christ gathering in his elect. In fact, what a catalyst that would probably be for revival. You know what an encouragement it would be for the church to actually have members and leaders who suffer for the message and suffer well to encourage the others to double down in prayer and in boldness. That's often how God builds his church. Persecution will not stop Christ, but will but serve his purpose in the end. All we need to do, brothers and sisters, is be faithful to speak. We sing that hymn from the Gettys. Christ will have the prize for which he died, an inheritance of nations. Bethany, we have the words of eternal life. We possess the only answer to man's deepest problem. Let us not hide the light under a bushel, but speak out and speak often. Amen. Let us pray that God would write his word upon our hearts. If you'd pray with me. Father, revive your church, we pray. Not only our hearts here at Bethany, but across this nation, across the world. Lord, we pray for your Spirit to blow upon all true churches, to give us a glimpse of the glories of Christ reigning in heaven, of Christ seeing everyone for whom he has died being brought into the kingdom. Oh, Father, we desire to see your will done on earth as it is done in heaven. We pray, Lord, that your will would be done, that your kingdom would come. Lord, we bless you that we have the privilege of being a part of that. And Father, I pray that you would grant us fresh measures by your Spirit. Inflame our hearts for the cause of Christ. Inflame our hearts to die to the worldliness that we are so often, that we so often have thrown in our faces from our culture. And Lord, that we would get in line with the vision of what you are doing on earth for the glory of your Son. Lord, impress upon our very eyeballs eternity. We pray that you'd impress upon us that we truly have but one life that will soon be passed, and that only what is done for Christ will last. Lord, draw near to us, we pray. Only you can revive your church. We pray that we would be those who are eager to pray this passage, that we would see it more and more fulfilled in our own lives, with our neighbors, in our communities, even at the level of civil government. But Lord, we pray as well that we would desire to see it happen, not just here, but all across the world, that we would see Christ's kingdom being established and built. Lord, be with us. Be the help of your people. Pour out your grace upon us. We pray that your church would indeed arise, and that we would, in your strength, go forth as the messengers of the kingdom. Be with us and draw near to us now in our fellowship time. Lord, we pray that we would speak of these things, that we would speak of your glory. Lord, that we would confess even our own sin, our own lethargy and laziness when it comes to spiritual things, and that we would encourage and sharpen one another to get back in the race and to fight the good fight. Help us, Lord, we pray. We ask all these things for your glory, and we ask it in Christ's name. Amen.